In 1990, the hot new trend in the video game industry was handheld systems. Nintendo started the craze a year prior with the Game Boy. Despite its monochrome screen, the Game Boy was a runaway hit. Nintendo expected to sell 9 million units by the end of 1990. Atari threw its hat in the ring with the Lynx, the first handheld system with a color backlit display. And if a company didn't have a handheld console on the market yet, they were on the way. NEC announced the Turbo Express, a handheld version of their TurboGrafx-16 console. And Sega, Nintendo's biggest rival, was busy working on the Game Gear. There was another company working on a handheld, although their name might not sound familiar, BDL Enterprises. Their idea was ambitious, a portable version of the Nintendo Entertainment System. Sadly, this device was never shown at trade shows and, ultimately, never came out. The man behind the project was a talented engineer named Paul Biederman. Biederman had previous experience as a technician at Capcom, working on arcade boards. When Capcom started porting games to the Nintendo Entertainment System, Biederman wrote the manuals for several releases, including Bionic Commando and Section Z. But soon, Biederman decided to go out on his own, and in 1989, he formed BDL Enterprises, also known as Biederman Design Labs. Based out of San Jose, California, BDL Enterprises primarily created test equipment for coin-op games, including JAMA and monitor testers. They even did some contract work for Capcom. BDL Enterprises regularly attended arcade trade shows to advertise their products and services. But that was a somewhat small, niche market. They recognized a huge opportunity in the home console market, which was exploding in popularity. BDL Enterprises decided to get involved. Their first and likely only consumer retail product was the Turbo Blaster, which retailed for $39.99. The Turbo Blaster allowed users to convert a standard NES controller into one with turbo and slow motion functionality. It was a neat idea, and Nintendo thought so too. It became an officially licensed product, and was even featured in Nintendo Power magazine. But Paul Biederman's next creation was even more impressive. Biederman took the motherboard from a Nintendo Entertainment System and stripped it of all unnecessary circuitry. By doing this, he created a new board that measured only 3 by 5 inches, a great size for a portable video game console. He called his invention the Express, a fully functioning portable Nintendo Entertainment System. The Express measured 6 inches wide, about 8 to 10 inches long, and 2 inches deep. It featured a 4-inch backlit color screen, built-in speakers, and a headphone jack with simulated stereo sound. The first version of the system had ports for NES controllers, but Biederman later added a built-in controller. NES cartridges loaded into the back of the system. The Express ran on 4C batteries. BDL Enterprises claimed the system could get 30 to 40 hours of battery life, although this was never confirmed. The company also claimed the console supported every NES game on the market, minus the Zapper Gun games. BDL Enterprises hoped to sell the system for a retail price between $149 and $169. That was almost double the cost of the Game Boy, but comparable to the price of an Atari Lynx. But the price was the least of their concerns. BDL Enterprises' biggest hurdle would be Nintendo. The Express used proprietary computer chips, which Nintendo patented. Without a manufacturing license, BDL Enterprises could not legally sell the system. So in 1990, Paul Biederman took his new invention to Nintendo of America, hoping to secure a license. But unfortunately, Nintendo officials denied his request. The problem was not the computer chips, but rather the concept of the system. According to a spokesperson for BDL Enterprises, Nintendo said that it does not fit into their long-term marketing plans at this time. That's the only reason they gave us. Nintendo was selling Game Boys like hotcakes. Adding another portable console to their lineup could potentially split their consumer base. Not only that, but it could also affect console sales of the Nintendo Entertainment System. It simply didn't make sense for the company to release a product like the Express. Video game magazines felt otherwise. Electronic Gaming Monthly called the decision unfair and speculated that the Express would have prevented Nintendo customers from going out and buying a color handheld like the Atari Lynx. GamePro and Game Players magazine suggested that perhaps Nintendo was making their own portable NES. And Video Games and Computer Entertainment proclaimed, "The Game Boy is quickly being overshadowed by the Lynx and the promise of a TurboGrafx-16 portable. We think Nintendo will someday regret not being more aggressive." BDL Enterprises, on the other hand, took the loss surprisingly well. A spokesperson stated, "Though we invested a tremendous amount of time and money, we're willing to honor Nintendo's wishes that it not be brought to market at this point. We are strongly behind Nintendo's marketing strategy." In the meantime, Paul Biederman kept tinkering. By the end of 1990, he had devised another idea, a Game Boy to NES adapter, which allowed users to play Game Boy games on their NES. Although such products already existed, like the Wide Boy, they were primarily used by developers and trade magazines. They also cost a fortune, about $300 to $500. Biederman designed his version for retail. BDL Enterprises also found a new suitor for their products, Comerica. Comerica had been a thorn in Nintendo's side. The company was known for their unlicensed products, including wireless controllers, game cartridges, and zapper gun clones. But their biggest hit was the Game Genie, from UK developer Codemasters. Comerica secured the rights to distribute the device in Canada, but Nintendo quickly sued to prevent the Game Genie from coming to market. However, a Canadian federal court ultimately dismissed the suit. Comerica rubbed it in Nintendo's face by taking out full-page Game Genie ads that proclaimed, "Thank you, Canada." Now, Comerica had their eyes set on Paul Biederman's creations. In June of 1991, Electronic Gaming Monthly confirmed in an article that Comerica planned to market both the Express and the Game Boy to NES adapter. But while Comerica was excited about these products, they couldn't discuss any formal plans to bring them to market. The following month, GamePro ran a story about some of Comerica's upcoming products, including the Express. According to the article, the Express now had the ability to hook into a television. The article also suggested that Comerica was planning to combine the Express and the Game Boy to NES adapter into one product. But for reasons unknown, Comerica never released either device. More than likely, the threat of potential legal action from Nintendo was enough to cancel the project. And behind closed doors, all was not well for Comerica. 2 years after teasing the Express, the Canadian government shut down the company for illegally routing their 1-800 number through Cuba. By July of 1992, BDL Enterprises was considered an inactive business in California. But the idea of a portable home console never died. NEC successfully launched the Turbo Express in December of 1990. In 1993, Bandai teased the HET, a portable Super Famicom, at the Tokyo Toy Show, but it was never released. In 1995, Sega released the Nomad, a portable version of their popular Sega Genesis console. When the NES patents finally expired in 2005, a flood of clone consoles hit the market. In 2012, Retrobit released the Retro Duo Portable, a handheld capable of playing a variety of old games, including NES cartridges. Although the Express never hit store shelves, it was an impressive concept. Playing the NES library on the go with a color backlit screen would have been incredible back in 1990. But even today, this idea thrives. Just look at the Nintendo Switch. As of 2023, the hybrid console handheld has sold more than 122 million units worldwide, making it the third best-selling video game console of all time. That's all for this episode of The Gaming Historian. Thanks for watching.
Funding for Gaming Historian is provided in part by supporters on Patreon. Thank you.